We moved to New Zealand from Argyll on the west coast of Scotland, where it's wild and beautiful, lots of space, lots of sky, lots of hills, and really the same things that drove us to Scotland are what's brought us to the Hokianga. It's landscape with soul, I suppose. So we're on 65 acres of mostly hill land, but we're fortunate in that the land also includes some good soil, some good garden places that are sheltered and good sun traps, nice soil. We've even got a small area of alluvial flat that we are looking to plough with the horses and grow potatoes and kumara, grain, pumpkins, the big staples. But for years before that, we were consciously, I suppose, skilling up with practical skills, gardening, woodworking, just all the practical skills that you need to be able to try and live in that way.
There's a number of things that are really important to us. We're trying to live in a more self-reliant way. We're trying to feed ourselves well. But I'm also passionate about seeds and about heritage vegetables and about being part of the move that's about saving those heritage vegetables and those seeds and making them available to home gardeners. The whole thing about the way that food is produced now is that because it's being produced industrially, the multinational corporations, generally speaking, that actually control the whole thing about food, they've picked varieties and they've developed varieties that have the things that they want, you know, harvest that's all together. They want uniformity. They want things that look like what we think a tomato should look like, because people think tomatoes are red and they're round because they're the ones that they've been sold. They don't care about the nutritional value because it just needs to sell. So it doesn't mean that it has to be nutritious, it just needs to be saleable. And they also don't care about whether it's disease resistant, because by and large, they're quite prepared to spray herbicides and pesticides and stuff all over it anyway. There's a practical reason why heritage vegetables are important, and that is because they're ones that gardeners can grow on organic systems. They don't need chemicals to keep the disease resistant. They don't get pests in the same way. They don't need to be aerially sprayed with herbicides and pesticides. And the things that they have, the characteristics are different to commercial vegetables by and large. You harvest them over a long period. They don't have to all look perfect, you know. They don't have to have thick skins. I mean, I think some of the tomatoes are bred to have thick skins now because that's what keeps them firm and looking like a tomato on the shelf. And there's a huge variety. I mean, I'm going to show you when I show you our tomatoes. We've got yellow ones and purpley coloured ones and green and red stripy ones. And, you know, there's so much has been lost that people don't even know that carrots aren't actually supposed to be orange. The original carrots were purple. And we've got white carrots and orange carrots and purple carrots and yellow carrots, and you know, and they're much more carroty than the things you can buy in the shop as well, which is like really interesting. So these are one of our heritage varieties of tomatoes that we grow. This one is called Alma. All of the tomatoes that I grow are what they call low acid varieties. These ones, they're beautiful tomatoes. Good for just eating fresh, but we bottle them as well. But the other thing that we do with these is that we dry them and then we preserve them in oil, and they're beautiful as like dried tomatoes. So that's a real treat in the winter to find the jar of tomatoes that you've forgotten about in the back of the cupboard. Thing about tomatoes is tomatoes are really easy for people to start seed saving. So for gardeners who want to grow tomatoes and actually start seed saving, these are one of the easy ones. And this is going to be lunch.
I'm pleased to hear that.
So I just wanted to show you the different varieties of tomatoes that we're growing. So I already showed you the Alma. But you see, tomatoes come in all different shapes and sizes. It's a really reliable one for us. Does very well in Northland. And again, beautiful salad tomato. They're all good for bottling though. So we bottle lots of tomatoes each year. We've probably got, I think we've probably got about 45 litres bottled so far this year. These ones are called Guernsey Island, kind of red with slight green stripe on them. That's an ox heart, which is, it's a small ox heart, it's not a huge one, but it's a, they're a beefsteak tomato, and they were a Dalmatian one that Dalmatian settlers brought, and they're a low acid one. This one is amazing. These are called broad ripple yellow currant, obviously little cherry tomatoes, deep yellow when they're ripe, very sweet. You have these going in your garden, your kids can just keep on eating them off the plant, like, instead of sweets and stuff, you know, they're so sweet and beautiful. And this one's called Black Roma, and you can see, this one's not quite ripe, but you can see that it's starting to develop a bit of a purpley dark kind of sheen to it. One of the other things that's really easy for people to start with is beans. Now, these are a green bean, that for eating as a green bean, called Blue Lake. And of course, these tripods have been full of beans. We've been harvesting them for weeks. But now they're past it, they're finished growing, finished producing the green beans. But these are the beans that I've let dry, and these will be my seed for next year. So it's so easy for gardeners to actually grow beans and save their seed. And you know, from each bean pod I'm getting, I don't know, what will I get, 5 seeds or something? And so it's really easy to actually grow your own seed for the following year. These are a variety of bean that's a drying bean, and it's fascinating to me actually how many, I've got friends who are experienced gardeners, garden for a long time, and they hadn't actually started growing beans for drying. And for us, this is one of our staples. So you know, like, you can buy red kidney beans and pinto beans and stuff in the health food shops and what have you. Well, like with everything else, there are hundreds of varieties of beans that were actually evolved for drying. And look at those. I mean, aren't they stunning? These make the most amazing baked beans. So these are one of our staples. We grow heaps of these beans for drying. Obviously, we're growing our own seed, because that's our seed for next year as well. But these are what we eat, part of what we eat over the winter. So we make, you know, we bottle our tomatoes, we make baked beans or bean burgers or whatever over the winter. And it's just, it's a really important part of what we do. And so simple. So in terms of growing your own food, and honestly, the vegetables are really easy. It's actually not that hard to grow significant amounts of vegetables to feed a family over a year. But one of the things that's harder is the whole issue of grains. So if I was going to grow grains for the first time, then these are the ones I would start with. And this one is called amaranth. It's beautiful. It's easy to grow. It's drought tolerant. If you have a really bad year, it just grows anyway. And basically what you're harvesting is the seed. Now I'm just rubbing this flower head, and the seed's just falling into my hand, and they're tiny seeds. And we use them in two main ways. One is to make amaranth porridge. So you soak them in water. We put a little bit of whey or yogurt in it overnight, and then cook it as a porridge with usually with stewed apple. And it's kind of good as a winter breakfast. But our other favorite way of cooking it is to dry pop it. So you know how you make popcorn? So we've got a deep pan. You don't put any oil or anything in the bottom, you just a dry heat, and you tip like a tablespoonful in, and it pops like popcorn would pop, obviously a lot smaller. And we have that as breakfast. It's easy to grow. It doesn't take up lots of space. From just this bed, we'll get a decent jar full of amaranth. So it's one that's good for people to start with if they're in a small garden and want to do something a bit different, and that kind of expands that boundary a bit and takes them into the grain field. And just see what it's like. The maize is actually just about ready to harvest, and it's beautiful, it's perfect. Look at that. So this is an old variety of maize, but it's actually an American one. It's called Blue Hopi. So it was a Native American Indian one. Really good as a flour corn, but also for things like making corn fritters. And there's a dish that we do which is corn with beans and pumpkin. So that's our own corn, our own dried beans, our own pumpkins, and then you serve it with a tomato salsa and some of our own cheese. So that's kind of cool, and our own onions in the salsa. So it's really important that what we grow are the varieties that actually belong here. And if you try and buy, so this brings me onto the seed thing really, because if you then try and buy seeds or plants commercially available, what you're getting is just versions of the commercial ones that they grow. That's what's kind of happened, is that the biodiversity in terms of food has decreased enormously. And that's really fascinating to me, because you hear politicians occasionally banging on about biodiversity. And biodiversity in terms of the environment and nature is really important, but there's another whole aspect to biodiversity that gets ignored completely all the time, and that's biodiversity in food crops. Because we have literally put all our eggs in one basket, or all our bananas in one banana box, and that, it's completely stupid. in a context of ongoing climate change, when we don't know what the climate is going to be as it evolves, we need to have as much diversity in our food as we possibly can, because by having that diversity, then maybe if the climate becomes not good for some things, we'll at least have some things that will still grow. So by planting stuff in your own backyard, you're doing all of those other positive things, and you're helping be a part of that whole move to keep the biodiversity in food. And the interesting thing is as well that, you know, if you buy some heritage seeds and then you start to grow them in your place, they will start to adapt to your place. It's been interesting this year because it's not been a good year here. It's been a hard season. It was a very cold spring. It was very wet. Then it was, so everything was late, and then it went very, very dry very quickly. But was also very, very humid. It didn't rain, but the air was very humid. So it's been a tough year for tomatoes. And I grow 5 varieties in this garden, and they're all heritage varieties, and they've all done reasonably okay with the blight. But it is interesting that the one that's done the best is the one that I've been growing the longest here.
It's been our belief for a long time that the capitalist world system that we live in is it's not sustainable, and it's not equitable. It's the antithesis of everything that permaculture should be about to us. We've always rejected it politically, and we were keen for a chance to step out of it economically as far as we could. We believe that one of the most subversive things that you can do is to actually produce your own food and your own necessities of life.
These are green apple cucumbers.
Never even heard of that.
Yeah, people are like, but it's round. Why is it? How is it a cucumber?
It does,
but it is like a cucumber. They're nice. They're very prolific.
Yeah, it was interesting going back to sort of food and corporate control and so on. Yeah, for the big corporations, if you can control where food comes from and you can control the food supply to population, then you've got an extreme control over that population. So food's really political subject. I mean, one of the reasons that New Zealand lifted its moratorium on genetically engineered foods was because of pressure by American business and the scrambling after free trade deals. So I mean the long arm of those multinationals affects domestic policy in New Zealand. So part of the solution is about moving away from that form of production to and the hope for more sustainable, more humane ways of living that don't distort people's lives and destroy their health and destroy their environments. Surely that's worth gardening for.
The thing about food is that when you look back, gardeners and food evolved together. Okay, so gardeners would grow food that would feed their families, and they would save the seed of the best stuff, the stuff that did well for them, and then they would plant that seed, and then it would the gardeners evolve with the food, and the food evolves with the gardeners in the locality that they are. And It's important on a nutritional and on a future planning basis that we don't only have 5 varieties of potatoes or whatever it is. partly because of the climate change thing and partly because of changing conditions. So a heritage vegetable is basically, it's an old vegetable, an old, you know, like an old variety associated with different places. So there'd be varieties of tomatoes or potatoes or whatever that would do well in a particular place, and they would be grown and have been grown for like hundreds of years. And the seed saving part of that is really important, because you can, these old varieties, you can save the seed and it grows true. Because you get a lot of people who are experienced gardeners who've grown their own food for ages, who don't close that loop up by actually saving their own seed. Because the saving of the seed is an important part of the whole process, and is a skill that we all need to learn, and is also really empowering in that it is so much cheaper to save your own seed. And the thing about seed is interesting, because sometimes I talk to people about seed saving and they go, oh yeah, I heard about this really cool place in Switzerland or Sweden where they've got this like vault in the ice and they put all the seeds. And I'm like, no, that's not what I'm talking about at all. It's like, I can see that there might be an occasion where we'll be glad that there was something in a freezer somewhere. But seeds are living things that should be evolving with people in the place that they are. So when I'm talking about a seed bank or about saving seed, I'm talking about keeping it alive and keeping it growing. So we're not talking about having it stored in cold storage somewhere. The best thing that could possibly happen really would be that seed saving became what it used to be, was that everybody did it. It was part of what people did, and that each area had their own regional heritage seeds that were just there and part of the culture.
Most of Northland's heavy clays, and it's quite humid, so it is quite hard on a lot of fruit trees. But the ones that the settlers brought here, you know, 100, 150 years ago, those that have survived have adapted and thrived. They're the trees that did well. That way they've been selected twice over. Firstly, settlers brought the best of what they had to come with them to the new world, and then the last 100 years has winnowed out the ones that couldn't cope with the climate and the soils here. As far as is possible, we are using our own eucalypt poles as fence posts, and we've planted quite a lot of woodlot trees, partly for firewood, partly for fencing materials. So we've planted deliberately a lot of trees that'll grow durable poles, like sweet chestnut. We'll be planting catalpa and robinia, black locust, yeah. Specifically with a view to fencing, and then other species for craft purposes, making tool handles or tools or kitchenware, furniture, all sorts of things. Yeah. For the future, we're hoping to plant hedgerows so that we're not necessarily reliant on a supply of wire for the future. Back in Britain, one of my favourite jobs used to be hedge laying. It's not something I think that people have probably even seen in New Zealand. The traditional way of managing a hedge was to layer it, which means you cut partway through the stem of each pleacher, as we called it, in the hedge, each individual tree, and then lay it over, and it'll regrow from the stump. The old stem will progressively die back, but as one lays on top of another, it closes up the bottom of the hedge. If you go along with a tractor and just clip the top of a hedge, eventually you end up with lollipops, so you've got sheep wandering in and out underneath because there's the stem and then it gets big bushy growth on the top. But if you layer them, the new growth comes right from the bottom, and the old growth is laid over one on top of another right along the hedge and makes a thick impenetrable barrier. Elder we have planted. It's hedging and a food tree. We use elderberries for in particular making juice, elderberry juice and wine. It makes really good wine. It combines well with damsons. My dad used to have the most incredible damson and elderberry port that he used to make. So hopefully we'll be able to make it as well as he did someday in the future when our trees are all bearing.
I'm going to show you the process of actually cleaning some seeds. So, you know, you've grown stuff in your garden and then you have to process it and get it actually ready either to eat, if it's the kind of seed that you eat, like amaranth, or to re-sow if it's something that you're just saving it so you can grow the plants again. And the process is essentially the same regardless of what it is. It so happens that what this is onion seed. So you can actually see the seed. Here, look, you see the little black things? They're the seed. And so the first thing you need to do is to get the seed out of the flower head. So in this instance, I'm just going to rub it. I'm rubbing it between my fingers. There's the seed and then the bits of the flower. So I've rubbed all the seed off there, and what I'm left with is a stubby little stalk. So the first thing I need to do is to actually separate out those big bits of rubbish from the seed. You can do this with the kind of equipment that you would have in your kitchen. So I've just got an ordinary colander here, and I'm just going to sieve the seed and the chaff through the colander. Now, if I was doing a big crop like amaranth, then what I would do is I would harvest the flower heads, big flower stalks. I would spread it out on a sheet or something and I would dry it, and you get it nice and crunchy. And then I would lay it on the floor and I would put a pair of clogs on, garden clogs, and I would walk on it and just stomp and dance on it, do what you like. And that gets the seed out of the heads, because basically you just need to get the seed out of the flower head. But in the onion, I could just rub it out with my fingers. So now, in the bottom of the bucket there, you'll see that there's black things that are seed, but there's also some small bits of chaff. So now, in here then, I've got the seed and I've got the chaff. And what the seed will be heavier than the chaff. So basically, you use the wind, and there's not much wind today, but you use the wind to blow the chaff off. So what's happening is the seed's dropping into the bucket, and the chaff's blowing away behind. And again, this is one of those things. It's not rocket science. It's quite simple. There's a bit of a knack to getting the breeze right, and there's not much breeze at all today, which is making it a bit difficult. So sometimes if the breeze was stronger, I'd have to hold the bowl nearer to the bucket. This is about the weakest I could get any effect. And I always pour from the bowl to the bucket, because if I tried to pour into the bowl, the seed would bounce and would go all over the place. So I'm always pouring that way. And you can see that it's much cleaner than it was, and that's with a poor wind. But that gives you the general idea. You don't need special equipment. This is a bit of net curtain from an op shop. It's really, you got to make sure it's the really fine mesh stuff, not the fancy stuff with big holes in it, because all the seed falls out. And so the onion seed gets hung up in there to dry. You get it nice and crunchy and dry. You get the seed out of the flower head, you get it in there, and you just use your basic kitchen colanders to get it as clean as you can, and then winnow it using the wind. So not hard, and anyone can do it. Cool. So if you want to learn more, then there's heaps of books. Seed to Seed by Suzanne Ashworth, Seed Savers Handbook by Jude and Michelle Fanton. Kay Baxter from Kawanga has written a booklet, which is how to save seed, basically. And you can get that off the Kawanga website. So there's heaps of resources out there. And then, as I say, in terms of actually saving it, I actually keep mine in little snap-lock bags, or you can keep your seed in jars in a cool place. The easiest place to start is beans and peas. They're the thing. If you're growing beans and peas, save the seed. Why on earth would you buy them? They're so simple to do. One of the things that people have often asked me is, what do you do about pest control? And what they've mainly meant by that question is, what do you spray on your plants to control the pests that is organic and isn't a chemical spray? But that's not what pest control is about for me. You look at pest control and it starts a long, long way back. And pest control starts with the soil. It starts with growing good soil, because if you grow good soil, the plants grow themselves. So you have to grow good soil, minerally rich soil, humus rich soil, and then the plants grow themselves and grow well. But another thing about pest control is about diversity in the garden. And if you look around this garden, there are hundreds of species in it. We've got flowers, the hedgerow, which has got lots of plants that are supporting the different flowers that flower at different times and provide food for the bees and food for the other insects. I've got flowers and herbs that I know have got specific companion planting qualities. Calendula is supposed to be supporting just generally of all plants. There's a plant called white alyssum, which encourages the predator wasps in that then takes aphids and things that would be harmful in an orchard, so we plant that around the fruit trees. We've got, I know that some of the marigold family repel eelworms, so there are things that I know, but there are other things that I don't know. I don't know whether the dahlias here have got a specific companion planting thing. I don't know whether echinacea has, but some of it, these are companions for me, and I think that the things like the dahlias are supportive. The bees love them, so that's got to be good if it's bringing the bees into the garden. But to be honest, these are there because I want them to be there, because I like them being here as being part of the whole. And I'm really content to actually sit with a situation where if I have lots of biodiversity in my garden, that nature will sort it out, rather than having to know the intricacies of every relationship there. So I'm a gardener and I do my best, and then every now and then something happens and you do get a problem with insects, and the first thing I would try would be exclusion. So that's why I've got that net over the brassicas. It's to keep the butterflies out. I actually haven't seen any white butterflies, but I put the net over anyway just in case. The next thing I would try would be physical control. So if I find some aphids on an onion or plant or something, the first thing I try is I go and I squash them off. And I just use my hand and I squash them. I'm a long way down the road before I actually try anything that comes out of a bottle. And only if something is really serious would I actually try using a spray. And then it would be something like neem or garlic and pyrethrum. And I have used those things occasionally, but it's not my first line of defence. Sometimes I actually sit and I look, and if I don't think it's going to actually kill the plant, I do nothing and just see if the balance is going to come. The other thing as a gardener that you need to know is you need to know about rotating your plants around your garden, because you do get a build-up of pests and diseases if you keep growing the same thing in the same soil all the time. And so by having it laid out in a bed system, I've got a plan, a record for every year of what's been in every bed, and I can make sure that I don't put the brassicas in the bed where the brassicas have been, because then you start getting club root and that kind of thing. I've used, in this garden here, in 3 years, I've used neem twice. So I'm going to show you how to make kefir. Now, kefir is a fermented milk product similar to yogurt, but with some differences. Now, if you're making yogurt, then you have to start with a live yogurt. And if you've got your own live yogurt, you just use that as a starter. If you haven't got live yogurt, then the way to start your yogurt is to buy a live yogurt in, or to get some live yogurt from a friend who's also making yogurt. With kefir, you can't just go and buy a product from the supermarket because it's just not available. So with kefir, you have to try and seek it out. And there are, if you even on Trade Me, if you put kefir grains on as a search, eventually it'll turn up, because there are people who are selling kefir grains, but you just have to search for them a bit. So the kefir is, as I say, similar to yogurt, but slightly different. Now I'm gonna make the kefir first so that I can actually show you the grains. So this is kefir that we've had sitting overnight. So it's actually formed into the kefir. And the first thing I need to do is to actually put it through this colander to sieve it. And what I'm sieving out is the fermented kefir, and I'm saving the kefir grains, which is what I use to make the next batch of kefir. And kefir, as I say, it's similar to yogurt, but it has different bacteria and things in it. And I gather that they're actually stronger bacteria. And so it's health supportive in the way that yogurt is, but in a slightly different way. I'm just going to actually help this along and push it through the colander. So all I'm doing is stirring it around. So what's happening is that the kefir is dripping through, and I'll be left with the grains, which I'll be able to show you as they materialise. You can see the lumps starting to form. It looks a bit like thick tapioca or something at the moment. The lumps are the grains. So all I'm going to do, I'm just going to put this back in the jar because that's ready to use. So what will happen to that is we will make that into a smoothie tomorrow morning. We'll mash up some fruit and some honey, and that'll be what we have for, as part of our breakfast tomorrow. So I'll put that out the way over there. So what I'm left with in here is this kind of gelatinous mass. Now I'm going to actually rinse it because then you'll be able to see the grains better. So that's the kefir grains. And so if you bought kefir grains, that's what you would get. So I'm just going to put them in the milk. You don't need as many grains as I've actually got here, but I don't want to throw them away because I think there's a friend who actually would like some, so I'm kind of just keeping them going because they expand each time I make the kefir. So I'll keep going and see it until I'm certain whether nobody wants them, and then when there's too many, I'll just feed some of them to the chickens. And that's it. So that's the kefir in there. And then what I'll do is I just put that there. So the difference, one of the differences between yogurt and kefir is you don't need to keep kefir at a warm temperature. It can just be left at room temperature. So that'll be it there until about this time tomorrow, 24 hours, maybe 36 hours. And then I'll just go through that process again. And that's it, every day we do that. It's a probiotic food. That means it's got live beneficial bacteria and yeasts in it that actually help support our digestion. One of the things that's really missing from our Western packaged diets is live food. Traditionally, in all cultures of the world, they had food live. It might have been salt pickled herring in Scotland. It might have been sauerkraut, you know, which is salt pickled cabbage in Germany. It might have been kefir up in, I think it was from like kind of Central Eastern Europe. Cultures had their fermented products, and it was one of the ways that they actually preserved food before they had freezers and canning systems and all that kind of thing. And it's, I mean, as I say, it's what we have for breakfast nearly every morning. So we make a litre a day at least, and drink that between us. It's just the two of us here at the moment. So it's pretty good stuff.
We usually let the milk stand for a day to let the cream separate off, which I could show you actually. Bear with me. That's yesterday's milk, and I don't know, there's the cream above there and separated out milk below it. So we'll pour off the cream and save that for making butter. And for yogurt, it's really it's a very simple process. We basically, to a jar that size, I would probably put 2 spoonfuls of our previous yogurt into it. And then what we would do is we would put it in this box. So it's just an ordinary chili bin. And we'd fill up 4 bottles with boiling water. And we'd put the jar in between, put a towel on top and leave it to stand for a day. Probably 24 hours. And at the end of that time, here's the one we did earlier. If I open the lid of that, you can see beautiful set creamy yogurt. Look at that, yum. And the worst that can happen, you know, if it doesn't make lovely creamy yogurt like that one, the worst that can happen is that it separates out. Do you see what's happened here? The yogurt's kind of solidified on the top. And the whey is separated out underneath. And that's absolutely no problem because this is then ideal for making the cheese out of. So the cheesecloth just sits into the dish, and then we'll pour that. There we go. And then I'll need to gather that without spilling the whey everywhere if I can. So that's got all the solids. And leaves the whey behind. And I should have had a bigger cloth for the amount of curds that I've got there. So that's going to be a bit interesting. There we go. And then just put my little pre-made noose of string around that. There we go, back to where we were before. So that'll then stand for a day, and then that'll be ready to go in the press as well. So it's pretty quick, eh? We could just eat that as a soft cheese now, so we could get it out of the cheesecloth, scrape it into a dish, mash some salt, mash some herbs, and it makes a beautiful soft cheese just like that. So if you're in a hurry, short of something for lunch, then you can do that. But I'm actually going to press this cheese and make a it's more like a feta cheese, so it'll be reasonably hard, and we'll preserve it in brine. And we don't need any fancy cheese moulds or anything, because if we just wrap it back up in that cheesecloth and get it fairly tight, or maybe just do that over the bowl or something because it might drip a bit more. There we go. And then tie it. And then what we use, I mean, we're gonna press this cheese, and you could just put it on something that will drain. I tend to stand it on the top of a colander to let it drain through. And you could just put any heavy weight on that would do. But we happen to have a we bought it off TradeMe as a fruit press, and it's actually a bit lightweight for being a very successful fruit press, but it makes a really good cheese press. But as I say, I mean, that's the only sort of slightly. Hopefully you should begin to see some whey oozing out. That's probably about as tight as I would want to go just at the moment. If I tip it slightly towards you, you might just... it's been pretty... Yeah, no, there's a wee bit of whey still got squashed out there. I don't know if you can see that. So that'll now sit for, till tomorrow morning. And I'll probably turn the cheese over and press it again, maybe a wee bit tighter. And then tomorrow evening, I'll take it out of there, take it out of the cloth. And just put it in a box with some brine, so salt and water, and then it goes in the fridge. And we usually try and keep it for 3 or 4 days before we eat it, just to let the flavour soak in. But it will keep for weeks if we want it to. So it's a very quick, easy cheese to do. We usually have a bit of a process going on, so we've got ones at different stages and ages as we go.
The example of Cuba is really interesting because in Cuba had its own peak oil a few years ago because it was an enforced peak oil with the embargo by the US and Russia pulling the support from Cuba, and they ended up with no fuel. And their whole agricultural system had been based on fossil fuels. So it's a standard, you know, fossil fuel based, using tractors, using big machinery, using all the pesticides and herbicides and fertilisers and stuff, and then it wasn't there anymore. They couldn't do it, and so they had to really quickly start to produce food. And a huge part of that food was actually produced in the cities. It was Havana produced like some massive proportion of its food really quickly, and it's a really interesting example of what people can actually do in an urban area if they set their minds to it. So in many ways, I think that the urban permaculture, urban organic growing thing is more important than what we're doing. That's where people are, and that's where the food shortages are going to be. Out here, there's less pressure and there's more resources, you know, there's just less population pressure. If there's ever interruptions to the food supply, then the people in the cities are the ones that are going to suffer. And so the more food production that actually happens in the city, the better for the people, the better for the biodiversity within the city, and the better for the kind of future as well. So I think urban permaculture is really important.